As with every video in this series, I like to put the build I used out there for transparency's sake, not to show what's meta. If you're looking for a longsword meta build, you might want to check out another video for that. I bounce back and forth between a couple builds. The first one is the Master's Touch build I used. I just took the typical Teostra set pieces and threw in the awesome Raging Bracky pieces for that Agitator secret. I have a ridiculous amount of Agitator combo decos, so instead of the Agitator charm, I threw in earplugs and finished that out. It's your typical damage build with all of the usual staples. I went with the Lightbreak Edge just for fun, since you get a maxed out blast attack as well. The next build I used was one that I wanted to have fun with the variant monster's new armor pieces, with the splash of the Big Bad Shara. This one takes advantage of the Agitator and Maximum Might secrets. I noticed I wasn't using a lot of stamina with Longsword, so I wanted to give Max Might a go. Out of the two, I enjoyed the second build much more. And now this build has become even more viable because we have a good wet fish farm. I used the Demon Lord Halberd mainly because of how awesome it looks, so if you have another Longsword you want to use, you can expand this build even further. Right off the bat, we come in with something that is extremely useful, especially for people like me that just got their first Mind Eyes deco very recently. To be fair, we've gotten a lot of weapons with purple sharpness, including both of the variant monsters' weaponry, but the fact that the longsword has some Mind's Eye built in is extremely useful in a comfort and tactical sense. You have plenty of monsters with hard spots or end up hardening through a fight. The Elder Dragons have plenty of these types of legendary resistance. For example, Kieran can very easily cast Stone Skin, our new buddy Furious can also do the same on his beefy arms. Being able to still cut into these parts and bodies comes in clutch when you can't claw onto the monster and soften up their parts. Not only does this keep you from bouncing off of a monster, but in terms of the EI slash from Sheath, you get a great buff in the form of a charging spirit gauge. Just having Mind's Eye on spirit slashes is awesome enough, but having an attack now that has an even higher reward for using it is incredible. With all good weapons comes versatility and flexibility. The longsword absolutely has both in the form of solid builds to the way you actually play it. The longsword really isn't much of a skill-heavy weapon. With that being said, you obviously sacrifice damage if you decide to skew away from the damage-dealing skills. But there isn't a save or suck kind of requirement like you have with the Gunlance, with skills like artillery or magazine capacity. Even my beloved Hunting Horn has a very strict tie to Horn Maestro. This helps to make your builds a bit more open to skills that you might feel guilty slotting in with other weapons, and this only becomes more prevalent the more you dive into the weapon. I ran with earplugs for most of the gameplay footage I caught, but you don't have to have earplugs at all with Longsword once you master the Foresight slash timing, because you can actually iframe through the roar, making earplugs obsolete at that point. I'm still trying to practice this and trying to get the timing down and training myself to just do this on instinct alone. Honestly, if you don't do this, you're losing out on playing the weapon in an optimal fashion, which is why I'm working towards using this exclusively instead of earplugs. Because not only do you dodge that roar stagger, but you can also follow up with the spirit gauge leveling round slash while the monster is open and vulnerable. In terms of the EI spirit slash, you have to be careful since you're wagering an entire level of your spirit gauge to do so. We haven't even talked about crit draw builds. The sheath mechanic actually opens up possibilities for crit draw and that beautiful frostcraft you get from Vel'Koz's 4-piece bonus set. There's some great moves you can do from the special sheath, so why not switch things up and take full advantage of them? This is a playstyle I'll absolutely be trying once I get to a place where I feel comfortable with the Longsword Spirit EI slash. Now, if you really want to have some fun, toss on that Impact Mantle and see what you can achieve with that. In all of the videos in this series, I preach about versatility in a weapon being key, and the longsword definitely checks off that list. Even though the iframes and foresight slash were narrowed, you now receive more moves that have them. The two attacks that come with the special sheath give you an opportunity to capitalize on some more juicy iframes. The timing of these obviously aren't something you can just pick up on the fly, but when you actually swallow your pride, take the time to fail and learn, you gain some of the most opportune and punishing moves in the game. And even then, there's still a risk reward that you're playing with. You could be the master of timing and still have moments in frantic hunts where you fail hard on getting that EI spirit or foresight slash off. But that's the beauty of this weapon and what keeps you coming back for more. The risk is high, but damn, is that reward oh so delicious. Having something as useful as iframes should be that exactly, and you have quite a few ways to use them with the longsword. I gotta start this part off by saying that I definitely still consider myself to be in the latter group, but in saying that, I still noticed that I was getting solid clear times with monsters. You'll notice that in these videos I'm usually going up against tougher monsters like Ruiner and Goldrathi in the background gameplay, not with the longsword. I took plenty of time to get really familiar with its mechanics and build up some confidence. Eventually, I took on tougher monsters like Ruiner and Furious. My times with Furious still aren't where I want them to be, but I'll continue to improve on that slowly but surely. Just be patient. That's a mistake that a lot of people make too. If you're trying out a new weapon type or one that you rarely play, don't jump into the deep end right away. Just because you're taking monsters out in no time with the hunting horn, greatsword, or whatever weapon, that doesn't mean it'll translate right away to the longsword. Weapons are so distinctly different from each other in Monster Hunter that you're practicing playing an entirely new game with each type you use. Luckily, the longsword isn't chock full of complicated combos, and even the higher skilled mechanics are mostly about timing rather than being straight up situational and when you use them. We all know that longsword is a weapon with a pretty high skill ceiling, but it still performs extremely well when you take away those skillful mechanics like timing and iframes. You can very much get by with sticking to the simple route of build up your spirit gauge to red, spirit helmbreaker, rinse and repeat. If you're a longsword noob like myself, you'll still have plenty of fun doing this alone. It looks flashy, it does solid damage. Now, if you find yourself jumping into the pro crew, you're gonna find yourself doing obscene amounts of damage, barely getting touched by the monster, and looking unbelievably cool throughout the process. You'll be countering with EI Spirit Slash or Foresight Slash straight into a Spirit Helmbreaker and leaving absolute devastation in your wake. Regardless of your skill level, you will still have a blast and you'll be able to take the monster out with ease. It's really hard to come up with a longsword that doesn't look extremely cool. Don't get me wrong, I know that Capcom has done it before, but the list of beautiful longswords is a tough track record to compete with. When it comes to the modding community, you have no shortage of absolutely gorgeous longswords. It really does have a nice variety as well. You go from Zangetsu from Bleach to multiple weapons from Nier Automata, back to the Monster Hunter world with crisp, actually good-looking Glavinus blades. I know there's a lot of Switch Axe users that tend to get the shaft for variety and weapon design, and that's absolutely true. But to put things into perspective, you take that and do a complete 180, and you'll accurately represent how much love the longsword gets in the design category. To be fair, it's honestly a pretty easy weapon to make look really, really good. You then move on to the actual animations of the weapon, and you open up even more opportunities to make the weapon look awesome. There are plenty of mods to make the longsword look flashy, but the beauty of it is that even when you completely scrub the effects, the sound and look are still hard to beat. Let your inner weeb flourish and appreciate the beauty that is the longsword. The longsword not only boasts flashy movements, but it can also tout an impressive amount of mobility, especially when you consider how much damage it can dish out as well. There are multiple ways of making sure that you have yourself pointed in the correct direction of the monster when it decides to not sit still. You can redirect with basically every weapon, but few have the amount of fluid and flexible redirection that the longsword does. Even the mighty greatsword has its limits on how much you can redirect that TCS in the moment. With longsword, you can do so without restriction in multiple ways. The very first relies specifically on the longsword's mechanics alone. When you sheath your sword, adding in a directional output will see you sheath your weapon while pointing in that direction. This is nice and accessible too because you can be mid-combo, the monster leaves the area, and you can whip right around to them and rip off a couple EI slashes to build back up that spirit gauge you might have been using. Even in the midst of your spirit slash combo, you can tweak your direction slightly, but not with nearly half of the efficiency of the sheath. Next, we come to the mechanic brought about in Iceborne. The burst shot. I can't tell you how many times I've gone through the spirit slash combo just to have the monster move and leave me pulling off a round slash in the complete wrong direction. Well, yet again, here's where that beautiful slinger comes in to save the day. Right before you let off that round slash, you can actually use a slinger burst shot in any direction whatsoever to get yourself back on track and ready to land that round slash and jump up a level in your spirit gauge. Not only can it redirect you, but it can also firm up your ability to actually hit the monster by staggering them if you have the right ammo in your slinger, such as thorn pods. The slinger burst has saved me countlessly already. Now, you can't talk about fluid movements without talking about the smoothness of the foresight slash and the EI spirit slash. These are sleek, awesome looking moves, but just the way that you glide so effortlessly is a thing to behold. The punishment you can bring afterwards is just as sweet, because it's just as seamless and smooth, because after you're done, you can pull that special sheath out and direct yourself right back towards the monster for a continuation of your relentless strikes. Now, this is where we all become longsword fans. It's easy to hate on longsword users. I used to do it routinely in base world, but when you find yourself high up in the air, ready to bring the pain with the spirit helmbreaker, in that moment, we're all weebs together. When you see a fellow hunter pulling this off for the first time, you have to pause and drop a single tear of pride because you remember your first time getting your spirit gauge to red and thrusting your sword into the monster and proceeding to rain hell from the sky and break that monster's helm or tail or whatever you hit. I talk about some of the best moments you can have with a weapon a lot in this video series, and with longsword, I have to say even more so than successfully using the foresight slash or EI spirit slash, I get so much enjoyment out of landing a spirit helmbreaker on a monster's tail and that being the final blow that severs it. All in all, the move is extremely fun to pull off, but it's even come in pretty clutch as far as sending me high up in the air and away from a monster's attack. There was quite a few times where it saw me vault over Diablo swinging its head back and forth, along with dodging explosions from lingering blast dust while fighting Teostra. Landing the Spirit Helmbreaker does require some luck to pull off while you and the monster are engaged, for sure. Landing the actual thrust is no big deal, but as soon as you fly into the air, the slightest gust of wind will have you crashing to the ground. And then if you're lucky enough to actually get up into the air, you then have to pray to the monster hunter gods that the monster doesn't move and you aren't left with a depleted spirit gauge and no damage to show for it. It truly stings, even more so than a missed TCS, because you get that animation of a slash with absolutely nothing to follow but the spirit-crushing shame of Senpai's disappointment. Using this move specifically with an impact mantle could be very fun with the amount of hits and damage that it does. Everything about the move from the initial thrust to the falling slash are just screaming for all kinds of flashy effects, and they absolutely do not disappoint when you have the right mods in place. I can very easily say that the time I've spent with the longsword has been the most fun I've had in Monster Hunter in a long time. And depending on when you're watching this, at the moment we're in a small bit of a dry spot for content, so having this much fun with the content at hand is a welcome thing. The longsword gets a pretty bad rep from people taking it into multiplayer sessions without the right amount of understanding and experience with it. I can honestly say that the outside influence kept me from trying it for the longest time. But deep down, I think it was me being a chicken because longsword is touted as a harder weapon to master. While this is true, the weapon from a broad scope really isn't that complex. Mastering the timing of counters and getting the hang of when to use what move is a bit tough, but when you just go for the base loop of the weapon, you not only still get great results, but you have an absolute blast doing so. I started off strictly worrying about getting my spirit gauge to red and ripping off spirit helmbreakers at will. I saw very solid clear times on that alone. After getting more comfortable with the mechanics, I started to bring in the risk-reward mechanics of the foresight and EI spirit slashes, and even when I failed, I had so much fun doing so. And when I actually happened to pull them off, it was a rewarding experience every time. You combine this with the great mobility, a special sheath mechanic that brought a huge expansion to the weapon's repertoire, and versatile ways you can wield the longsword, and you end up with a recipe for a weapon to be the most popular in the game. But that's gonna be it for this one. If you've been hesitant to try the longsword, do it now. Take it on solo hunts, get comfortable with it, and let out your inner weeb. Take out some of the lower totem pole monsters and work your way up. I can promise you, you won't regret it. If you liked the video, please let me know with that thumbs up. Comment down below what you think of the longsword, and if you're someone who's more experienced with the longsword, drop your tips down in the comments so this can be a one-stop shop for people who are on the fence about trying out the longsword. Subscribe if you haven't already for more Iceborne and other gaming content. And even if you have subscribed already, be sure to hit that bell to make sure that you're notified about new videos, because in prime YouTube fashion, I've been told on multiple occasions that people aren't getting notified about new videos. But you guys have a good night, and happy hunting.